Yeah, I mean, for me, it was like in those days, no, don't do that. Don't talk to me about Jesus. I don't want to hear that. And, you know, it wasn't until, you know, August of 1998 when I was at the very peak of my career. I mean, that was at the very highest, 97, 98. Yeah. And you know, because some people say, oh yeah, he was, you know, he was starting to be washed up at that point. And so, you know, he turned to a Christian, you know, to be a Christian, and he got weak or whatever. It's like, no. I had more money and more power and more fame worldwide than I ever had. And, you know, you want the raw deal here? I mean, the raw deal is I was approached by my ex-wife so many times about, you know, life on the road and other women. And I, man, not only did I tell her no and lie to her, but I could make her feel so guilty for even asking the question. I was such a good liar.
Oh, wow.
But the truth of the matter is that there were women on the road. Mm-hmm. And so, I was cheating on her, you know, throughout the whole thing. And, you know, I was confronted one last time, in about 1998, August of 1998.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I was probably, I don't know what it's like to have a nervous breakdown, but I must have been very, very close, because, yeah, I had, you know, lawsuits from other, you know, one other wrestler in particular. I'm not going to mention his name, but sorry to keep doing that to you.
That's okay.
There's no sense in
it. That's fine.
But he was suing me, and I actually feared for my life, you know, a couple times.
Wow.
He was suing me for something that, you know, it was just crazy. And, you know, Vince McMahon was, you know, tugging on me at the time, and
yeah.
Eric Bischoff was tugging on me at the time, and, you know, WWE, WCW, what, you know, should I make the jump? What should I do? And you know, all these companies make a variety of products with my name and likeness on it, and just there was so much going on at one time, and everything was slipping through my fingers with all the power and all the money and all that I had. I mean, I was losing control over everything. I knew that, you know, my marriage was not good, and, you know, I had these two young sons who I loved, and they loved me, and they needed a dad, and I knew that I was messed up. I was on painkillers and muscle relaxers. I was drinking every single day. The only time that I was sober for about a 2-year period, the only time I was ever sober was when I was in the ring, or if I had to rappel out of a helicopter or from the, you know, the top of the arena and down into the ring. These were the only times that I was actually sober.
Wow.
And so for me, you know, in August of 1998, I was confronted one more time by my ex-wife, and she asked me about women, and, you know, that was just something came over me, and I had to tell her the truth.
Mm.
And I didn't get caught, but I confessed everything to her. And, you know, there's scripture that would back up everything that I did. You know, if you want to, now I am preaching.
James, no, it's 5, okay.
16, James 5:16 says, confess your sins one to another so that you may be healed.
Mm-hmm.
And the fervent prayer of a righteous man accomplishes much. And so one to another, meaning the one that you have hurt, the one that you've sinned against. And
yeah.
So I did that. I confessed everything to my ex-wife. I told her there isn't anything that anything she asked me. I was honest and truthful, and told her. And it was horrendous. It was one of the worst moments of my life, watching her lifeblood just come out of her. Almost, it was just
yeah.
It was just horrendous. And you know, God, at that point, you know, I said, okay, I have given God lip service I literally said this prayer. I've given you lip service, oh Lord. And I had, you know, nothing was real to me. It was like, wave your magic wand and fix everything.
Yeah.
You just fix everything. And, you know, he doesn't care about, you know, working with people like that. He, you know, not from the outside in, but from the inside out. So he, first he wanted my heart, and he never had my heart because it was only lip service until finally August of 1998, you know, when I realized, okay, there's no amount of money, no amount of power, no drug, no woman, no man, no doctor, no nothing.
Right.
Nothing is going to fix this horrendous, deep, dark despair, and I have messed lives up everywhere.
Wow.
And I cannot fix this on my own. I need something supernatural. And I said, God, I surrender my life to you, and that's Jesus Christ come and live inside my heart. And so that's what happened to me in August of 1998 when I was at the very peak of my career. Muscle relaxers, painkillers, alcohol, women, you know, a lifestyle, even language that comes out of my mouth. Everything changed radically overnight. And I was watching my friends die from this kind of a lifestyle over the years. I mean, it's like, you know,
that's true.
Knock, knock at the door, you know, no answer. So you got to push the door open, the chain's there, you know, because you've asked the maid for the key, you know, and you open the door and you see the legs and, oh, he's in there. But, you know, you go in there and he's dead. You know,
yeah.
Or, you know, in the dressing room, clear, you know, paddles to the chest, and you're trying to revive somebody who's literally flatlined, you know, and so we were seeing this stuff all. I was going to be one of those guys. And,
wow.
I knew I was on my way, you know, to potentially, you know, not only losing my, you know, my marriage, my kids, possibly my life, you know.
Yeah.
And so the supernatural that I needed, you know, I said, no more lip service. This is real now. I'm going to live my life for you now, from now on. Jesus Christ, I want you to become my Lord and Savior. And so that's what happened to me in August of 1998. And
how powerful.
And I've never looked back.
That is so powerful. And I mean, it just goes to show you, you know, in this whole thing when we call the chase for glory, right? A lot of people think that it is. You're chasing fame. You're chasing money. You're chasing material things. And a lot of times, and I've seen it myself, I have a lot of friends that have a lot of money, and yet they are so depressed.
Yep. That's it. I was one of them.
Yeah.
You know, for me personally, I was not able to handle, you know, the fame and the money and all the power. I just didn't know how to handle it. And so, you know, I made all the wrong choices and suffered all the most severe kind of consequences one can suffer.
Yeah.
And, you know, but, you know, I've never looked back and, you know, I managed to stay in the pro wrestling world, even, you know, with the massive change that happened in me in August of 1998. I mean, I'm still Steve, you know, I still love wrestling. I still love going to the gym and, you know, working out with the guys and, you know, being on the road and, you know, none of that has changed. It's just
right.
A lot of the choices that go with that have changed.
So
here's the amazing thing. I always say, you heard me talk about rules, rules, rules. I didn't want to live by rules and regulations. That's a lie that comes from, you know, the enemy of our souls, and that's the devil. He wants us to believe these things that, you know, you're going to live by a bunch of rules. I mean, if you're changed from the inside out, now things are different. It's like, you know what? I don't have the desire to, you know, be so numb from alcohol and, you know, painkillers and muscle relaxers and whatever else. I don't have the desire now to, you know, all my desires have changed.
Mm-hmm.
So from the inside, everything has changed. It's not hard for me to walk by the bar, you know, when I check into the hotel. I mean, I walk right by it, you know. I mean, there's no sense for me, you know, getting close to the fire. For me, you know, I don't even want to come close to it anymore. So.